Hey everybody, welcome back to Altium Academy. I'm your host, Zach Peterson. In this video, we're gonna continue our discussion on grounding involving Ethernet interfaces, and specifically, should you clear out ground below any of the differential pairs in an Ethernet interface? Now, in our previous video on Ethernet, we looked at a viewer question involving the LAN 8742 Ethernet PHY interface, and in that question, the central point revolved around removing ground below the differential pairs in the interface. So should you do it? Well, what I'm gonna do is show three different examples involving the clearance of ground below differential pairs. And then I'm gonna show you how to properly use a MagJack connector for an Ethernet interface. So make sure to follow along in Altium Designer. Let's go ahead and get started. So if you're reading application notes around grounding with Ethernet interfaces, different application notes will recommend different strategies for grounding or placing ground below the differential pairs that make up the Ethernet interface. The ground will also be different on either side of the magnetics termination circuits. Magnetics play an important role because they provide isolation and common mode noise rejection from the Ethernet lines coming into the system. First, just as an example, let's take a look at a typical strategy where we have a PCB, and then I have a PHY right here. So this would be like our LAN 8742 component that we discussed in the previous video. This PHY is then going to have lines coming off and going to a magnetics termination circuit, so we'll just call it mag. And then this is going to come off to our connector. Now there's also going to be a termination circuit, and this is called a Bob Smith termination circuit. And if you want to read more about Bob Smith termination, I'll include a link to a blog in the description. Make sure to go read about that. So this is the basic layout or the basic topology that you'll find in an Ethernet link. And the idea here is that the magnetics are terminated with this termination circuit, and the magnetics provide coupling across an isolation gap into this connector. The question then becomes, if we have an isolation requirement in Ethernet due to this magnetic circuit, where should the ground plane be located? Well, this is where you'll start to see recommendations like we saw in the LAN 8742 routing checklist, where you have ground removed from this side of the system. And so essentially you would have a split in the ground region where you have digital stuff on this side of the system, and then you basically have nothing on this side of the system. So here on L1, we would have our signals and our components as we see here, and then L2, we would have our ground, except in this region, here we would have L1 as SIG, but L2, we would have basically nothing. And then it would be cleared below the rest of the stack up. So we basically just have some differential pairs routing right out of the magnetics into the connector with nothing beneath it. Now, we did see in that example in the LAN 8742 application note that there was some other ground regions and some copper pour, you know, on this layer, on L2 in this region of the board. And that's fine, but the point is that there's a large separation between those copper pores and these lines. So this is one strategy for doing it. And if you look at a Renesas application note on industrial Ethernet, you'll see that they actually do recommend doing this. In this case, what'll happen is then if this connector is shielded, it'll then be connected to chassis ground, while all of this stuff is connected to a digital ground. And then you'll have some connection somewhere else in the system between chassis and the digital ground, somewhere near the power input for this system, so that you have a consistent 0 volt potential that is referenced everywhere in the system. Now, this strategy provides the maximum amount of isolation between the output side of the system or whatever else is going on out here in the environment, and then the rest of the system where we have all our components located. So a variation on this will, instead of just having the chassis exist here near the connector, maybe with a ground ring, you will actually have chassis essentially extending all the way beneath these differential pairs over to this region where the magnetics are. and the magnetics will just couple across this gap between this ground region, which is our chassis region, and our digital region over here, which is then used for the reference on the Phi. So this is just a variation on the previous implementation, and now instead of L2 being ground on this side, we have L2 just being chassis. And that allows for some other components here in the chassis region, maybe on other layers as well. So this is just a variation. It also provides high isolation. It also provides noise suppression for any noise that might be received in this region of the system on this differential pair. This is good if you have a noise issue and you still want to balance that against isolation in terms of galvanic isolation across this gap leading into the Phi. Now, sometimes in this case, what you'll actually see is you'll see these two connected somewhere in this region, where you basically have your ground region on the digital side connected over here to the chassis ground on this right side near the connector. And so this cap could be placed somewhere in this region, essentially leading across the magnetics. So that's another way to tie these two together so that you have a consistent 0 ohm potential at high enough frequencies. I think the better strategy involving chassis ground, as I've mentioned several times in the past, is to tie them back together at one point at the input of the system, unless you have a reason to pass high frequency signal across this gap in this way. And of course here, if you're operating at very high speeds, there is a reason to do this. You can actually put this cap here across this gap to ensure that you have a low impedance connection between the digital ground region and then the chassis ground region. And the final method for implementing grounding here when you have these discrete magnetics components like this is to do away with this type of separation between the left side and the right side of the system, where you basically just have all of this as being digital. Now you can still connect the connector to a chassis if there is a chassis point available. And if it is available, it will be available somewhere around this edge. So that's still possible. But essentially this type of grounding just runs the ground all the way up to the edge of the connector. And now you just have digital ground everywhere. So I think in this case, this is also still appropriate because here you have high speed signals moving back and forth between the magnetics and the connector. And so the return path for these signals is going to exist here in this region. So unless you start putting other components like here in this area or here in this area, you're really not going to see any of that noise pass from this region over into any of these other components because frankly, you shouldn't put them here to begin with. Now you can still have stray currents that move across the ground plane from the connector side over to the Phi side. And so if you want to prevent that, or if that's going to be a problem with implementing isolation, then you shouldn't use a full digital ground plane in this configuration. I believe that you should use the full digital ground plane because this ground plane is going to suppress noise reception in this section of the system. And that suppression of noise is very important. We want to suppress noise, of course, even in differential pairs because differential pairs are not immune to noise. They can still receive differential mode noise, which will not be canceled out by the magnetics termination circuit or the Phi. It can still be read out on the Phi. So this is best for noise suppression. So because we have all of these different grounding recommendations, there is actually a shortcut that you can take that just bypasses all of this. And that shortcut is, instead of just using a discrete magnetics termination circuit, we just eliminate all of this. And instead, we use a specific type of connector called a magjack. So a magjack connector, as I'm drawing right here, essentially is useful whenever you have a very small system that doesn't have room for any of the discrete magnetics, because all of those magnetics are going to be built into the RJ45 jack. It's also useful when you don't have a chassis. So small IoT devices like an Arduino that have an Ethernet port, they have a magjack on them. And of course, that magjack can then just connect back to the digital ground on its shell. So now you have a single ground everywhere. You have the magnetics that are built into the jack. You don't have to worry about placing and routing termination circuits, and everything is easy for you if you just use a mag jack. You don't have the same level of isolation that you might have if you physically separate all of the grounds, as I showed in some of these other options, but this is the easiest to implement from a placement and routing standpoint. So here in this example, I have a project open, and this project, as you can see, uses an RJ45 connector here along the board edge. If I put this into 2D, of course I have it on single layer mode, so you can't see where the ground is, but if I just turn off single layer mode, you can see right here on L2, we've run ground all the way up to the edge of the board and underneath this connector. Now, if you just trace these RX and TX lines back over to the BGA over here, you will see that there are no magnetics circuits. So that should be your clue that this is a mag jack. And in fact, if I just select the components filter and then drag this over like this, let's deselect that capacitor here, we see that this particular part number is a 1000 base T mag jack. So you can see that right here in the properties panel. With this type of connector, as I said, you can just route this all the way up to the edge. And then you can see here that we have some mounting holes that are built into the footprint. Those mounting holes are, of course, important. Those mounting holes allow you to mount it to the board, but those holes are actually not plated through holes. These are just standard holes. These other two holes, S1 and S2, are connected to a capacitor on the back layer. So if I just go to the back layer, you can see that there's a capacitor here, and this capacitor connects back to ground. These connections here allow you to dump high frequency noise back into the system ground. And that's important because there is only a single ground on this PCB. It is the system ground, or the digital ground, that supports the routing of these signals into this mag jack connector. So if you want to use a mag jack, it's very simple. You can just follow the guidelines that I'm showing here on screen, and this is going to provide maximum noise suppression, as well as allow very easy layout and placement and routing of the Ethernet interface that you want to put into your board. So in summary, should you clear the ground out below differential pairs in an Ethernet interface? If you're using a mag jack connector, you don't even need to worry about it. Mag jacks have the magnetics termination circuit built into the connector, and you don't need to worry about clearing ground below those. In other cases, it really depends how much isolation you're trying to achieve in the system, as well as how much noise you can tolerate coming into those differential pairs from the secondary side of that magnetics interface. Just make sure to keep these different options in mind if you're ever reading application notes on Ethernet routing. They are going to recommend different grounding strategies for your system. All right, thanks for watching, everybody. Make sure to hit that like button, hit the subscribe button. Of course, leave your comments in the comments section and tell us how you do Ethernet routing in your PCBs. Thanks again, everybody. And last but not least, don't forget to call your fabricator, folks.